Yesterday, we have seen this one that is programmed I/O, why this is inefficient. So if there are any doubts in this programmed I/O, someone can unmute and talk to me. If no doubts, we'll proceed with the other one, interrupt. So I'll just count down so that someone can come forward if someone having doubt about this programmed I/O. So countdown starts 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. So I assume no doubts here. So let us go to this interrupt I/O. In this interrupt I/O, as been said here, let us go to our this one. So here we have this one. This is our processor here. Am I audible to everyone? Yeah? Hey, no one. I think you people are.
Yes, sir.
Yes, okay, sir. It's audible.
Yeah, thank you. So, this is our processor, and we have some I/O devices, let us say here, some I/O devices. This I/O device, earlier, yesterday what we have seen, it is the job of the processor that all the time it has to check here that inside this we have something called status register. Yesterday we have said that there is only one flag register, flip-flop, single bit register that we are focusing. Apart from that, there are lot many flip-flops here. Put together them, we were calling like a status register. So this was the yesterday's discussion that this processor should go here and check this that is flag register. Whether this I/O is ready to give any data to this processor or not. So for that, this job processor is doing here. If this I/O is sitting here as a flag bit as 1, then this processor starts taking data from this I/O device, and which is this way it is happening. Like this is happening. How this is happening? 1 byte each time. 1 byte. So this 1 byte data. Was taking yesterday, we have seen something 10,000, I guess, some microseconds just to transmit this. So till that time, this processor cannot attend any other task here. If it is doing some task here, for example, maybe a multiplication program, suppose. So this multiplication program, this processor, this is a multiplication program for a task. This task for a while, this processor has to stop till this I/O device completely sends not its data to the processor. So that is called this checking here. This you see this line here. This is going here all the way and going to the flag register. This is done. This is happening with the help of a instruction, that set of instructions. So I/O instructions. Them we call I/O instructions. They program. So this program is actually executed by this processor. And this program will check this flag register. If this is set to 1, then it takes data from this I/O device 1 byte at a time. So that way, this is taking this much of time just to transmit 1 byte. So likewise, if there are several bytes, so many times it has to keep checking this, the other byte is ready or not. Then it has to wait for this time so that this entire byte can be transferred to the processor. So meanwhile, this processor cannot perform this intended functionality. This functionality it cannot perform. So for that reason, what we are doing now, we are going to this one that is called interrupt. So this is the processor. Your processor is doing some task here, T1, T2, one after another. If this is T1 is done, then it may go to T2 like that. So some few tasks are it is performing. So this processor is busy doing all this. So if it is doing all this, then we have a mechanism here in the I/O device. So what it does is in the I/O device, there is a mechanism called interrupt mechanism. So this interrupt mechanism, what it does is the job of this interrupt mechanism, this is a program. This program's job is to check here flag. To check flag here. So it is not going to execute this processor is not going to come here all the way and check here this flag. So design that this interrupt is placed here in the interface module itself. Here that interface our interface module. From very first session we are talking about something called interface hardware. This interface is there resided here inside here. To this interface, actually, this your I/O device is connected. This I/O device is connected through via this interface. This interrupt is placed inside this interface. This interrupt will check the flag. This process, this I/O, whether this I/O device is ready to communicate or not. Who is checking now? This processor is not checking. This interrupt is checking this flag. If this is ready, then this interrupt is actually sending a request to the processor that this is ready. So by doing so, what is that we are doing is we avoid this checking here all the time. Here this has to come and check this one here, and then this 10,000 yesterday's example. For microseconds, it has to wait because this is transmitted here to the processor. Because this other the second time this flop may be set to 1 or it may be set to 0. This processor is not going to take up any of the tasks here since this communication already started. These tasks are for a while are postponed by the processor. And this processor is now busy with checking this flag here, flag gate. Now what we are doing is we are eliminating this checking itself. This checking itself we are eliminating this checking. Checking we are eliminating this checking. If we eliminate, what happens then? If this flag is ready or not, who is checking now? This interrupt program is checking. This interrupt program is checking. Where this interrupt program? This is there inside this interface module. It's checking this one. If this is ready, this flag is set, then this interrupt is sending a request to the processor saying that this I/O device is ready with some data. So now what it does is this processor, though for a while it is pausing, but it will not pause for this long. For this long, it is not going to pause. Just to initiate the transfer, it pauses for a while, and then it what it does is the control lines are transferred to the this data bus. Now data bus is actually taking this data register contents here. Data register, these are through the data bus going to the processor till this processor transmits the control to the data bus here. Till that time, these are postponed. Once control is transferred to the data bus, now the communication is happening between this I/O device to here to the memory. This processor is now will be taking up the postponed tasks here. It starts again taking this task here. Whatever the task being postponed, it will attend that task. This who is handling now this one? This one is directly handled by the data bus from I/O device to the this memory unit. Is that clear to everyone? This interrupt how actually is helping us. Is that clear to everyone, this concept? Any doubts here? Are there any doubts here? If those having doubts, they can unmute themselves and they can ask. Okay, countdown, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I assume no doubts. So let us go to this one here. Let us read now this theory what we have this related to interrupt. In the programmed I/O method, CPU stays in a program loop until the I/O unit indicates that it is ready for data transfer. This was the thing we said earlier, that this programmed I/O, the last session that we have seen here, this programmed I/O, in that case, CPU stays in program loop until this I/O unit indicates that it is ready. How this I/O unit is going to indicate through that flag? Now, this is a time-consuming process, since it keeps the processor busy needlessly. So this is the very point. Yesterday also we discussed here why this 10,000 times it is waiting, and that is called time-consuming process. Today also in the paint software we have demonstrated how this is the time-consuming process, this one, this programmed I/O. So it can be avoided by using an interrupt facility and special commands to inform the interface to issue an interrupt request signal when the data are available from the device. This was the point in the paint software we were talking about. It can be avoided. This time, needlessly, the CPU is waiting. It's a time-consuming process. This problem we can avoid using an interrupt facility and special commands to inform the interface. Interface, you know very well, that comes between CPU and the I/O devices, this interface module. To inform the interface to issue an interrupt request signal when the data are available from the device. In the meantime, CPU can proceed to execute another program. Who is handling now? CPU, earlier case, earlier here in the programmed I/O, it is CPU that is coming and checking the flag bit. But in this case, it's an interrupt that is going to handle whether this I/O device is ready with the data or not. This interrupt facility is going to handle. Since CPU is not checking now, it is interrupt that is handling this data availability of the I/O device, ready or not. This CPU, since it is not checking now, this CPU now can do some another tasks. So the interface meanwhile keeps monitoring the device. This was the, again, in the paint software being said, in the this interface will keep monitoring the device, this interface, because the interface is now upgraded with a interrupt facility. That interrupt software will keep checking whether the device is ready or not, this is I/O device. So who is monitoring now? This interface is monitoring. So when the interface determines that the device is ready for data transfer, it generates an interrupt request to the computer. So this is also in the paint already I discussed, this one. So upon detecting the external interrupt signal, since this interface has detected that now the data is ready from the external I/O, what it does, it generates an interrupt request to the computer. So upon detecting this request that is coming from the external interrupt signal, that is from the interface unit, so the CPU momentarily stops the task it is processing, branches to a service program to process the I/O transfer, and then returns to the task it was originally performed. So this was also being said in the paint program, that CPU momentarily stops the task it is processing and branches to service program. This service program is nothing but handling the data bus that I/O device can transfer to the memory, that is service program. So this service program, it branches, CPU branches to a service program. Why service program is required? To process the I/O transfer. to process the IO transfers. Once the service program takes over the process of IO transfer, this CPU returns to the original task and then returns to the task it was originally performing. The CPU momentarily stopping and going to the asking the service program, this is another program, Baba, you go and start this IO transfer between the IO device and to the memory. So that momentarily this job is done by the CPU, and then after this moment this CPU comes back to the originally what it was doing, this some tasks it was doing, so it comes to that. So that's how this interrupt is really blessed. We can save that time. Now coming to the same again, the stuff earlier in the paint what we had discussed. The CPU responds to the interrupt signal by storing the return address from the program counter into a memory stack. CPU responds to the interrupt because CPU is already actually here. It is momentarily stops the task. So momentarily stop the task means it is something like this. You have suppose here. This is your CPU doing some job here. Your computer is doing some job. So this is say T1 task 1. Say here you have T2 task 2. So now CPU actually at this point. So let us say the address is here is the address 0, and then here is the address 1. Here is address 2, likewise some addresses here. So we don't know what is address transfer. So that is that. So as you know, there is a something called your PC. Anyone guess? You just guess what PC is? PC we already seen in a common bus. So that is program. What's that? Program counter? Anybody? Is that correct? Yes, somebody should answer. Though not having doubt, yes or no. What is PC? We have instruction register, we have PC, the program counter. Are nobody responding? Somebody respond. That's how you show that your presence.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Some other guy, some other?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So,
yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So, it shows you your presence. So, this this program counter actually points to the next instruction. So, currently CPU is executing this instruction 0 means this program counter will be pointing to the this next. When CPU count control comes to the first instruction, and program counter will update itself to the next instruction so that it can fetch from that location. Likewise, it is going to fetch. Suppose say currently it is there at this address CPU is executing this particular instruction at second, then program counter will be updated with obviously with the next address. So that next address is 3. So but when it is doing this second instruction, when it is executing, this has received a request. CPU has received a. This is your CPU box. So some box is here, some other hardware which takes the interrupt request. So this has come from this interface unit. So to this interface unit, we have some I/O device connected. This I/O device is connected to this interface. This interface is sending a request now. So because this is now upgraded with the interrupt facility. So this interrupt now, what it is doing is, it is going to send a request to the CPU. This hardware actually looks into handling this interrupt sort of. So now this CPU actually working executing this instruction. This is there with this second instruction. So very unfortunately, at this very time, this has come. meaning what? It cannot go to here, this address. It should attend, the CPU should attend this request, and also it has to preserve this return address. When this is done, this request is accepted, that is interrupt request is attended, at that time CPU has to take care that the return address is 3. When pointer comes to the control comes back here, it should attend the third address. So meaning what? With this, what I am trying hard to convey you is, it has to store this return address somewhere in the system. That is again in the system computer itself, it has to preserve. So this is another memory, let us say, return address storage memory location. So return address is stored in this memory. So this is return address. When CPU attends this request, it does all that job earlier explained, that transferring control to the data bus, and then this I/O can start transferring data through that data bus to the CPU memory. Somewhere here is a memory. So to that it is transferring. So then this job of transferring control to the data bus, some other control in the data bus, after that it has to come back here to this location. So what it does is, how it comes to this address, it goes here, this control again, before coming here, control actually goes to this one here, this return address, and it fetches the return address. Return address is stored here, 3. Now PC is updated with this address. PC is updated here with this 3. So when this PC comes here, happily PC will point to the 3. Now from 3 on, this task, without it losing any meaning, it is continuing the task. So this complex mechanism is there involved here. So that is what we are talking about. This one here, this one here is, let me take that point. The interface meanwhile keeps monitoring the device. When the interface determines the device is ready for the data transfer, it generates an interrupt request to the computer. Upon detecting the external input signal, interrupt signal, the CPU momentarily stops the task it is processing, branches to the service program to process the I/O transfer. This branches, transferring control to the data, some other unit, and that some other unit will look into transferring this I/O to the memory. So this is done with the help of another program called service program, and then returns to the task it was originally performing. This we covered. We were actually talking about this one. The CPU responds to the interrupt signal by storing the return address. Here, actually, we would have taken up this one straight away from that paint software to here, because from here only we had gone to the paint software. So the CPU responds to the interrupt signal by storing the return address from the program counter, this PC I was talking about, PC, into memory stack. So that in the paint separately we have drawn some memory. So in the memory stack, and then control branches to the service routine. This service routine is this service program. Before actually attending this service program, CPU preserves return address. It stores in somewhere in the memory stack, and then control branches to the service routine that processes the required I/O transfer. Yes, at this point we will take some feedback from you people. Is that clear concept? Very clear. Is that very very much understood by you people or not? Because these are definite questions. These are external point of view, definite questions, and concept should be clear. Now, no doubts about. There is no countdown. Simply, you have to acknowledge that yes, concept is clear. Yes. Nobody, you can unmute simply. What is that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. One, the other. Are there people?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's great. Are there people? Only two guys are there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you so much. But this is not fair. You had to unmute yourself and interact. So that is how this is handling. The way that the processor chooses the branch address, of the service routine varies from one unit to another. So some methods here, actually how this is return address is stored here. This return address, I was just talking about this one. This address, let me take some other. This one, this return address, CPU has actually kept the return address here in some this memory. So how is that mechanism is handled? Again, this is again simply like that. It cannot come and keep in this memory location. No, there should be some mechanism. So that mechanism is this one. So there are two methods to accomplish this. This is let me take this. The way that the processor chooses the branch address of the service routine varies from one unit to another. There are two methods for accomplishing this. One is a vectored interrupt, the other is a non-vectored interrupt. In non-vectored interrupt, branch address is assigned to a fixed location in memory. In a vectored interrupt, the source that interrupts interrupts supplies the branch information to the computer. This information is called interrupt vector. So here again, I repeat this 1, 2, 3, 4 points. The way that the processor chooses the branch address, it has to branch to the subroutine here, this one here. CPU momentarily stops the task which is processing, branches to service program. This branching, so this branch address of the service routine, varies from one unit to another. So where this service routine, interrupt, to handle the interrupts, let me go back again here, take up this fresh page. The fresh page is, again, this is processing very quickly, complete this. We have come to the this one. It should come here, actually it is executing in our earlier example, second instruction. So when it is executing second instruction, this PC is actually loaded with the next instruction. But at that point, when it is actually performing this instruction execution, we actually had received a interrupt request. Interrupt request has come from this interface. So to which this I/O device is actually connected. So this interrupt request needs to be handled by this CPU now. So meaning what? This all interrupts are actually here somewhere memory. Let us say this is your memory. You have some memory here. This is some memory. And there are types of memories. We have something called RAM and something called ROM, read-only memory. This is actually during the program, during this execution. Here it is executing task one. Then later on it may execute another task, another program. So likewise, depending upon our user developer programs, all these things are happening actually. So all these programs are actually there in the RAM. They are running from the RAM. All instructions are running from this one. But this ROM here, it will have pre-planned programs in the ROM. So this memory I am talking about something, some sort of ROM, not RAM. This is something called a ROM. Let us say, as I said, in the ROM, what will be there? Pre-decided some programs we keep in there. Pre-decided or pre-planned. So what my pre-planning is, if it is coming from the printer, some instructions should work here. This portion is for the printer. And this is for some other I/O device. Suppose, say, for example, what interrupts we can say, there is a, what we call, any help? some emergency interrupt, what can come to the computer. Some plant is there, somewhere some plant is there, some plant here. So in this plant here, temperature should not exceed 60 degree Celsius. If it is exceeding 60 degree Celsius, it should give the interrupt to the processor. Should give the process to the processor. So let me get this phone off. This one. It is going to the processor actually. This interrupt is going to the messed up this pens here actually. Yeah, now it's here. This plan should give the interrupt to the CPU actually. CPU. Now CPU, what it has to do, it has to go to the that interrupt, it has to attend this interrupt request and the related instructions immediately it has to execute. So that is called branch. So this is this in at this branch I'm keeping plant related all decision making instructions. This plant when 60 degrees it is exceeded, so immediately what actions I have to take, so those instructions I am keeping here in this address location from here this point to this one. So this is again this is another branch. So this branch deals with the plant related controlling instructions. So now depending upon the request that is coming to the CPU, this is earlier we took to the printer, no? So let us say this is a printer. This is a printer. If printer related requests are coming, then it should go and execute this subroutine. If plant related emergency coming, this should be given higher priority and these instructions here, set of instructions, these instructions should be executed. Like that, we have all set of pre-planned, pre-decided, instructions. We kept in some memory called, this is the ROM memory. Now, when this request is coming from the plant, this CPU should go here to this address and all instructions should read it one after another to maybe to decrease this decision making, what to what sort of instructions are required, all been kept here. So then it is going to execute. So this is called branching. So if this comes, it should branch here. If this comes, then it should branch here. So this branching ability, how is that CPU is going to branch? If this comes, it should branch here. If this comes, from plant comes, then it should branch here at this location. So this branching ability, that branching ability, we are talking about this somewhere here. Let me take again this laser. This one. The way the processor chooses the branch address of the service routine to which request we have to service. The service program, I said printer in that location and the plant in some other location. So the way the processor chooses the branch address of the service routine varies from one unit to another. Yes, this is very obvious. Your computer home, our domestic computer not required plant handling this sort of interrupt requests. Our home desktop is required enough with a webcam, printer, and a USB port, and mouse, and some other stuff. But in the industry, those computers, those are handling automated way systems are handled. So they have different service routines. So emergency service routines, that plant example I gave. So that's why that depends, the way the processor chooses the branch address of the service routine varies from one unit to another. So in this context, the context is you have to continue from this to here. There are two methods of accomplishing this branch address. So one is a vector interrupt method, the other is a non-vector interrupt method. So in non-vector, this second one, in non-vector interrupt, which address is assigned, we have fixed its location in memory. So you remember at this point, I will go back to the paint again. You please remember, in non-vectored interrupt, the branch address is assigned to a fixed location in the memory. This is the ROM I am talking about. And there is a fixed location for that particular given interrupt. There is a location is fixed. That this interrupt means, in the earlier paint example, we took that the printer and the plant. So for printer, that 0 to 10, let us say, that is fixed. And for plant, 11 to some 200, let us say, huge number of instructions are required, suppose, because that's a complex plant handling. So 11 to 200, that location is fixed for the plant. So that way, so non-vectored interrupt branch address is assigned to a fixed location in memory. Whereas this first one, vectored interrupt, in vectored interrupt, the source, who is generating source, maybe printer, maybe plant, maybe USB, that is your plug-in device, that is called, what is that? Pen drive. Those are the I/O devices. What I mean is basically I/O devices. Source that interrupts the supplies, the branch information. Who is providing this branch information? Your plant will provide, suppose interrupt coming from the plant, that itself will provide where I am, like 11 to 200, Baba, I am. So go there and execute like that. Who is providing the branch required set of instructions where they lie in the computer? Who is providing that information? That interrupt itself is providing. But in the earlier case, in non-vector, interrupt is not providing any information related instructions where they are. Who is making decision? The CPU itself will make decision. That's why it is fixed. In domestic computer, all are fixed, because we don't do any atomic level sort of activities in home. So that's why that is non-vector. Mostly in the domestic computers, non-vector. But here, industry, so we source will provide the branch information to the company. This information is called interrupt vector. So that's how we complete this interrupt, interrupt initiated this one, data transfer. So here I just stop and I ask any queries here if you have any questions. Are there any questions? Is that clear? First of all, you just tell me. I was talking about this one.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, the which the source to the source you usually go to do interrupt.
Can you? It's a very breaking your audio. Can you be slow, bit slowly, and give some big pauses and be loud enough.
Sir, the address which the CPU delivers, it is delivering through the interrupt.
Address is delivered through the interrupt request in the case of vectored interrupt type of method. There are two methods how this branch address is provided. So in the one method is called vectored interrupt method. The other is a non-vectored interrupt method. Non-interrupt vector method. In that approach, this branch address is actually CPU handling. Who is handling? CPU handling. But in a vector type of case, the branch address is provided by the source itself. If printer is interrupting, printer itself will tell that where my related instructions are there in your memory. If plant is interrupting, plant will provide where my related instructions are there in your memory, in your ROM. So that is called vectored interrupt. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Are there any more? Okay, I assume no more. Let us proceed to our countdown mechanism. So we count down 5. In between, if there are any, you can come forward. Our count starts now. So countdown starts now. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. 0. So let us proceed to another. this is another mechanism. We were so far we dealt with the programmed I/O and then interrupt, and then there is another thing called DMA, which is the direct memory access. The direct memory access is a sort of interrupt only, interrupt type of approach. But here, before going to this, I just go here for paint friend. And with this, we wrap our session. So in DMA case, what happens is, here you have CPU. And here you have your DMA, that is direct memory access, DMA. And here you have your I/O devices. Actually, I/O device, every I/O device is through. Again, you should not forget, every I/O device actually having, so these are I/O devices, let us say these are I/O devices. Every I/O device has got its own interface, that you should not forget. At least till you finish not your exams, you should not forget that every interface, I/O device has got its own interface. So now, if this I/O, suppose say we have one, two, some devices here. So this device wants to communicate some data. It wants some data from the CPU, or it wants to give some data to the CPU, suppose. So here we put something called memory also. So now what is happening here? This I/O interface will actually request a DMA, that it wants some data from the memory. Two possibilities. One is from memory to I/O device. Second possibility is from I/O device to memory. So both are possible, no? So this may want to put some, or it want to read some data from the memory. So that's why these two cases. Now what we do is, CPU will be keep doing its own business. That is, some business, whatever the user assigned, task one, task two, task three, some programs, will be keep doing that. So if this I/O device wants some data from the memory, then simply it requests this DMA. It is not requesting now to the CPU. It is not interrupting. It is, see, two things are not happening. First thing is CPU not checking. This is not happening. This is not happening. And the second is, interrupt is not coming to the CPU. This is also not happening. These two are not happening in this DMA case. What is happening then? I/O device is directly talking to whom? DMA. So what it conveys, what it requests DMA, that I want to put some data from memory to I/O. I want to take some data from this memory. From this memory to this device. I want some data. This is trying to access this. Or else, this I want to put some data into the memory. So that is I/O to memory. So this may be happening. So, but these two cases are going to whom? Going to DMA, another hardware business. DMA, direct memory access, is another your hardware. What it does, this DMA now, based upon the request that has come, that is, maybe it wants from memory, or it want to write to the memory, based upon whatever the request, it simply requests to the CPU that I want this job, either job, this one or this one. So what it does, the CPU, for a while away in interrupt it has done, in interrupt case it has done. So that is, it is going to the branch address, routine, service routine, And then the service routine is actually looking after I/O transferring. So that had happened in the interrupt. But here this is not going to service routine now. What it is doing is actually, it is the CPU is handling control we call here, this is control, bus control request, this control. This control is related to memory, because CPU is not it's a computational device. Everything is actually our main memory. So this control CPU transfers, it is currently doing this job. So for a while, what it does is, it tells this control hardware that, Baba, I am releasing the bus here. The CPU actually supposed to holding some bus here. What buses will be there? One is a data bus, the other is a memory bus, the other is a control bus, right? We have seen them in the I/O devices, first slide of this I/O pro, this unit. So one is a control bus, the other is a data bus, the other is this address bus. Control, this is the first one, control, and then address, and then data. This control, for a while, what it does, the CPU to this control, it tells that I am releasing now this control. I am losing my control over the bus, and you can control this bus mechanism. I will write down here this bus mechanism. This bus. What are the buses here? One is a control bus. The other is a data bus. The other is a, what is that? Control. I'll write on it. It's better to write it because I am forgetting. So this is the control. There is a data. What is left? Address. Now it is clear. Control, data, address. Now what CPU does is, Baba, this control over these buses, I am releasing to you. You look into now. Earlier, this control over these buses, who is having control? CPU was having the control. Earlier, over these buses, this control bus, this data bus, this address bus, who was having control? The CPU was having. Earlier, control was there with the CPU. But the moment this devices, either of the devices, maybe want to accept from the memory or they want to give to the memory, they are simply requesting the DMA. DMA is requesting to the CPU that you lose the control over these buses and give that bus control to me. Who is asking? This DMA asking. So now CPU, what it does? It merely gives the bus control only. To whom it gives? To DMA it gives. That's it. Nothing more. The DMA is that one. Because after all, it's the game of the bus. That this has to transfer all through from this to here, this memory. The game of bus game. So this bus game is a control mechanism, no? Bus game is, it is also complex, but who is controlling? Earlier, CPU was controlling. Now what we are doing? We are releasing the control from the CPU and giving that control to whom? Another hardware called DMA. Now, CPU still can, losing the control over the bus, CPU still can continue with the tasks given here. Because tasks are something computational, no? Arithmetic operations or logical operations, they are not related to the bus. So those are the computation related. So that's why this computation still will go on, though CPU for a while is giving this control of the bus. Remember, the control of, we are talking about the control means control of the bus we are talking about. Control of the bus is given to the DMA. Now DMA, since it has captured the control of the bus, it starts, it is having a complete data of this memory. Inside this CPU, this memory is there, no? This memory has got some range here. This memory has got some range, suppose say here like this. this is the range here, 0 all through suppose say 128. So every information is also there with the DMA. So in which location it is there, requesting this IO device, or in which location it wants to write, every information will be there in the DMA also, the way CPU has got information and DMA also will have. So while handling the CPU control of the bus to the DMA device, the CPU passes this information to the DMA, that bus, range, memory locations, this range information of the CPU also will passes to the DMA. That way DMA is updated with the memory locations. That way now DMA can know that from which memory location this particular IO device is trying to access data, or in which memory location this IO device wants to write in. So that information now this DMA is aware with. Just because while handling this control to the DMA, CPU also handled the bus this address information also. That way this DMA knows. So with this I stop this one. I did not start DMA. I just gave you the introduction of how this is different from this one. Interrupt, and how this is different from your programmed IO. This we have three cases. One here. We go here. This programmed IO, interrupt initiated IO, and DMA. We discussed programmed IO clearly. We discussed interrupt initiated IO clearly, and I just gave the introduction to the DMA. So technically, how really it is happening, that in the paint software, what all I have discussed, that needs to be discussed. So that needs to be discussed. So in next session, we will take up this direct memory access technically. But as a concept point of view, we took in the paint that how what is the role of DMA, and how DMA is actually playing a role in data transfer from IO devices to the memory, and from memory to the IO devices. So with this, I wrap my session. And if you have any queries, you please stay here and ask. If you don't have any queries, you happily can sign out.
When CPU is giving the control, then how it is able to transfer the range of the information, range of the memory to DMA?
Wait. Hello? Yeah. I'm just trying to stop my recording here. Wait.